Are you using meaningful measures? Numerical values may not tell the true story, a case study of jet lag. Counting our steps with a Fitbit, making daily visits to a digital scale, dressing according to values on a thermometer, monitoring calories ingested or expended, money earned or spent, social media, likes, or their absence, all have the power to pull our focus outward, to push us to rely on standards that may or may not have much to do with what our own bodies can tell us. Do these numbers really answer questions about what matters in the larger scheme of personal experience and life management? 140 years ago, psychology began its march towards acceptance as a legitimate social science when Wilhelm Wundt opened the first research laboratory in the discipline at the University of Leipzig, in Germany. Johns Hopkins University established the first American psychology lab in 1883. Across the years, from then until now, research designs have become more complex and illuminating. Statistical analyses have become more sophisticated, moving from simple means, standard deviations, and correlations to sophisticated techniques, like hierarchical linear modeling or Cox survival regressions after computer technology offered mechanical assistance. Conclusions tended to rest on assumptions of a normal statistical distribution, although violations of the assumptions, the outliers, could be identified and addressed. Variations developed. Alan Kasdan explored clinical studies based on repeated measures from a single person. Bayesian statistics offered a legitimate alternative to traditional analyses. Meta-analyses became the standard for review studies. Recently, an emphasis on failures in replicability has thrown accepted findings into question. Recommendations include more rigorous trials, the publication of studies that failed to replicate meta-analyses and Bayesian analyses as ways for us to shore up confidence in the findings. Criticism of the errors resulting from investigators' biases, whether conscious or unconscious, has gained attention along with proposals for ways they can be transcended with reflection, standards, and effort. During the same recent decades that have questioned our designs, biases, and statistics, qualitative research approaches to our understanding of human experiences have gained a respectable, sometimes even honored, place in the way we see, conduct, and honor our discipline. My favorite manual, John W. Creswell's Qualitative Inquiry and Research Design, Choosing Among Five Approaches, was originally published by Sage in 1994. The fourth edition debuted in 2018 with Cheryl Poth as co-author. Qualitative methods help us identify ways in which complex human behavior develops and is experienced. Researchers can later test the resulting concepts and theories with rigorous empirical studies. Why have people often become skeptical of psychology's findings? Christopher Ferguson argues that psychologists and their professional organizations need to communicate more effectively, limit their assertions when appropriate, and clarify differences between psychology grounded in hearty research findings and pop psychology based on, at its best, a simplification of legitimate science or, at its worst, musings drawn from one experience. And so we navigate these waters, searching for truths that are universal or at least may apply to us as individuals, and those in which our own complex histories, genetic makeups, and contexts place us outside the normal distributions and their assumptions of any particular findings. What does this mean in day-to-day terms? For starters, we must monitor when we are going too far in believing that numbers or statistical values always show the way, whether by demonstrating truth or progress or comparative standing. First, the conclusions associated with the numerical values may be wrong. The October 1, 2019, announcement in the New York Times that eating red meat may not be bad for us after all offers an example. It asks us to reverse a belief that was heavily promoted by public health and medical entities over decades in the face of new information from a multinational meta-analysis. Second, the conclusions may not apply to any specific individual. In the case of red meat, for some people, quantities may be deleterious, just like for some people, quantities, too much or too little, of wine or sleep or work may create problems while for others they promote optimal functioning and development. Article continues after advertisement the famous quote usually attributed to Henry A. Murray, a father of personality psychology, remains true. Some people, originally written men, changed by me for inclusivity, are in some ways like all other people, in some ways like some other people, and in some ways like no other people. It is our task, as psychologists, whether we are working with others or applying findings to ourselves, to address ways in which any unique individual's development follows universal, group, or idiosyncratic trajectories. I submit that our bodies, home for our consciousness, hold many keys to identifying differences. This brings me back to the beginning of my topic: are you connected to the feedback from the body in which you are living, with all its associated sensory and mental components, or do you rely on numerical values from an external measurement to interpret your own experience? Our cells, and thus our bodies, are ever-changing and evolving, often more quickly or subtly than strictly objective measures can register. For example, when my extremities become cold, I realize I have become tired, even though a thermometer would continue to register the same body temperature. Do you notice when your body tells you that you are becoming tired or hungry or even, like the child caught up in its play, that you need a bathroom? AA has a saying captured by the acronym HALT: be aware of your vulnerability as you become hungry, angry, lonely, tired. Last week, after ignoring the impact of a 6-hour east to west jet lag, I realized that hunger, anger, loneliness, and tired feelings were all tumbling on top of each other. My husband and I had plunged into life as usual when we reached home midday, following 28 hours of travel and wakefulness. We changed our watches and consciously decided to ignore our biorhythms. We ate according to the clock, on local time, showed up for events as they occurred at their regular time slots on our calendar, and went to bed at a reasonable local hour. We chose a lighter dinner of cereal and fruit, a slightly earlier bedtime, and showed up for our routine Saturday morning activities, a study session for him and yoga class for me. Initially, our bodies seemed to go along with us. Lying down for a nap at 4 in the afternoon should have brought the normal boost it brings us each day, but my body refused to cooperate with my head. I could not doze off or even slip into a familiar meditative state. The next day, it all converged. Same time, worse biological rebellion. I was hungry, angry, tired, and my determination to soldier on had left me isolated and feeling lonely. How many times do I need to be reminded? When I override my body, it will rebel to show its primary authority. As I trembled with cold in our heated home, frustration rising to fury, my mini tantrum only pushed my loving husband further away. Ultimately, our energetic bodies require attention and respect, or we behave in ways that make our situation worse rather than better. In this situation, when I realized what was happening, I stopped and then chose a long walk in the fresh air, an apology for my outburst, a period of deep and deliberate breathing, and a vow to go to bed shortly after a sensible, balanced dinner. In the morning, East Coast routines intact, I would feel and act better. This time my body's adjustment took a bit longer, requiring a little more compassion, modification of activities, and patience. A few days later, I was back to my more familiar self, having been reminded that the body always knows the deeper truth, and vowing to remember the lesson the next time. Do you listen to your body, and do you know when to push it and when to stop? When the external reference point is an invitation to injury, and when it is a goal worthy of pursuit? Can you accept that you change from day to day, that you are affected by the circumstances and environment around you, and that external information may or may not be useful or, in fact, be applicable?